hello. Welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. I have a treat. My guest today is really an icon among rock and roll, punk rock, all of the bands you have looked at and listened to in the last, 20 years, can I say that?
You can say more than 20 years, actually.
All right. Yeah. Duff McKagan. And the book is entitled It's So Easy and Other Lies, published by Simon & Schuster. Welcome, Duff.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Oh, listen. This book is like going into a time machine because you walk into it and then you go through all the experiences you went through growing up first in Seattle.
Yes.
Then discovering that you really wanted to be in a band and coming to Los Angeles like a lost soul,
yeah,
trying to find a place.
That's it.
Yeah. And then all of the things that happened to someone with that era of drugs, etc.
Indeed.
Yeah. Who was the first person in Seattle who said, Dr. John, who said to you, hey, Duff, you got a future?
In Seattle. So what happened was, last of eight kids.
Yeah.
So that's a lot of people.
Yeah.
My dad was a fireman, and so you can kind of do the math there. We dealt with eight kids. We got what we got, and we were, yeah, happy with it, but we had family. But, yeah, everybody played an instrument, and so there was instruments laying around, and I was the youngest one, so all of my older brothers and sisters were heroes to me.
Yeah.
So I wanted to be like him and her and him. So I wanted to play guitar, and I wanted to play drums, yeah, and bass and be like my older brothers and sisters. Now, I also wanted something of my own. That you want something of your own with that many kids.
Yeah.
Punk rock hit when I was about 13. So all of a sudden, there's something that's new and fresh and my own. And you could go out and kind of form a band right away and go play a gig right away. Mm-hmm. And you didn't have to be a genius,
yeah,
player,
yeah,
yet. You could just, it was all intent, good intent. And so I started playing in bands. And I played drums in one band and guitar, yeah, in another, and I played bass in another. And it was just, I found my thing. And,
yeah,
I excelled at playing with bands. And in group situations, I was good because I grew up in a big family. So it seemed to all fit. And just kept playing, and I saw, I don't know if anybody told me, but I just felt like, this is what I want to do, this is what I'm going to do.
Yeah.
That's what, and by the time I'm 17, this is what I'm going to do.
Now, drugs, etc., you're very open about it in this book, so I'll bring it up. I think you started when you were like 14 up in Seattle, and coming down here, it just was sort of like, somebody would say have a cigarette, they would say have a pill.
It was just, I think, yes, so maybe it's my generation, because,
yeah,
it's not just me, you know,
no,
like,
yeah,
all of my friends and, yeah, and people I grew up with, not just friends, but people my age, we have these similar experiences.
Yeah.
I did LSD in the sixth grade. Sixth,
yeah,
grade, now I see my girls growing up, one is in the sixth grade now, one's in the ninth, and I see how young they're kids.
Yeah.
And I look at myself, that's my kids started my reflection into the past.
Yeah.
Because I was living through them, me again. And I was given a column over 3 years ago in the Seattle Weekly, out of nowhere.
Yeah.
We have a Thursday column, Duff, you're a Seattle guy, will you write it? Oh, will I write a,
yeah,
column? And suddenly I was sort of thrust into this, okay, a deadline and a,
yeah,
column, and I was a terrified first week, mm-hmm, and the second week I was a little less terrified,
yeah,
and I started to find a voice, however,
yeah,
by like the fourth week, and I found I could articulate my thoughts and things, yeah, and whatever,
yeah,
much better in written word than I ever could talking, and started to get a little following there, and then I was offered another column at Playboy, so suddenly,
yeah,
I had two columns, and I started to write these side stories,
yeah,
that weren't the columns, they were these little honesty,
yeah,
it was, the file was called, in my Word file, on my computer was called Honesty at first. And I'd stick these stories in,
yeah,
there. Being honest about my own past.
Yeah.
Trying to find my truth through my life. The truth, mm-hmm, not the thing that,
yeah,
you...
Listen, there are couple of times in this book where you're so truthful. that I thought, why didn't he poke those people in the jaw, give them something? One was, okay, you join with Axel, Guns N' Roses, goes through a desert of time, and then suddenly David Geffen's people have signed you up, and you are hot.
Yep.
And then suddenly something about greed and megalomania were two words you use in here. And it happens then with Axel. Everybody suddenly, they bought their house, they want more. And again, it happened with you with somebody, I think his name was Scott.
Mm.
It's almost like, wait a minute, here we go again.
And my path has been there for a reason, and I have to see it that way. And I don't state in the book that Axel got greedy, or I'm just telling my story within that thing, because nobody got greedy. It's just we didn't know how to deal with suddenly everybody. We were just five guys, you know, writing music for our life. We didn't know what else to do, and it was just us, the little gang. And once other people started to get involved in our thing, and the money, commerce started to become, then it was other people's greed, I believe. And
well, it feeds in. If there's somebody saying, well, you should be getting more. You're doing more than.
Yeah. There's always that.
Yeah.
And that's life, isn't it? I think.
Yeah. And I think you guys, really, the five of you, had it good for much longer than most.
We had a good run.
Yeah.
We did. And a lot of people have asked me, God, don't you wish the band was still together? And I'm like, you know, this band was, we were brutal and honest and real. And anything that real and honest, and we were on 10 at all times.
Yeah.
It wasn't an act, it wasn't a thing, a shtick or whatever. And when you're going that hard, to last 9 years or whatever it was, eight years, it's pretty good. And
but
it was great.
But it was also an agent coming and saying, you got to sign this or not. And you're put under that pressure and you're naive. And
tired.
And tired.
I was tired.
And an innocent, because you didn't know business at that point.
That's correct.
Yeah.
They don't teach you, you know, there's no handbook. There's no how-to video for a lot of these things. And
a lot of musicians get really tossed out on the street later on because they say, wait a minute, I wrote that song. And you discover that a manager or somebody had the rights to your song.
That's one thing we knew about. Sort of. We knew enough to not sign any of our songs over to anybody. And that we knew. So fortunately, you know, that was a trap we didn't fall into.
Yeah. When you left Guns N' Roses, what was going on in your life then?
Well, okay. So when I actually left.
Yeah.
So that was a couple of years after we played my last gig with the band, I guess you would say. What was going on? A lot of good things was going on in my life.
Yeah.
And I was becoming, I was finding out who I was as a, was I a man yet? Who am I? What's my identity?
Yeah.
And I when I got sober, my first sense I remember coming back really was my smell. And that smell just welled up all of this stuff. I smelled newspaper print, which reminded me of my newspaper route, which in turn reminded me of being 12, you know, and I could smell freshly cut grass and all of these things.
Yeah.
And I could smell the lake water in Seattle. I could smell Lake Washington.
Mm-hmm.
Reminded me of being on the lake and a family. And, okay, I'm not Duff, the punk rock guy, Duff from Guns N' Roses, Duff, the king of beers. I'm none of those things. I'm just Duff.
Yeah. But thank heaven you discovered that there was something martial arts.
Yeah.
That was your saving grace with a guy named Benny Jett.
Benny the Jett.
Yeah. He actually has put out some books that I have gotten through the years.
Yeah. He is, you know, he's really sort of my personal hero in life. And I always, you know, when I get stuck into a corner, even with my girls dealing with a parenting issue or if I'm out on the road and I'm lonely or I was like, what would Sensei Benny do?
Yeah.
And it just I only say that. It's a little mantra. What would he do?
Yeah.
And it brings me down. And yeah.
Because you had gotten into that sort of the not, it's not a rut, but into that groove of meditating, the martial arts, and now you're on the road and you've saved a few people. You're going, ha ha ha, look at me. And
yeah, then, yeah. You got this whole thing down, don't you?
Oh, I read your book.
Yeah,
it's
you
all
did.
In here.
Wow.
As a matter of fact, it'd make a great movie. But truly, that thing of get, and then the word you just said, tired.
Mm.
When you're tired, hello.
Yeah, lonely,
yeah.
Tired, hungry, all of those things, angry, stressed,
yeah.
But tired, you know, tired. And for me, lonely, I live this strange life, and I'm not sure why, but to make money, I have to go on the road, and
yeah.
That's what I do, and I'm a musician, that's what I do, so often I have to leave my wife and kids, and
yeah.
This is the place I,
yeah.
My home is my thing, and I'm there to be the father of girls, and be there.
And you who had only known sort of the guys and the boys, and suddenly the yeah. Girls are saying, Daddy, I need lip gloss.
Get my nails done. Yeah. A purse. Do you need another purse? I mean, we have purses here. Dad, God, no. You need.
Yeah.
You need or you want
yeah.
It? Well, I want it.
Yeah.
Okay, that's different than need.
Yeah.
So, but I love it. You know, it's I see the joke
yeah.
Of being a dad. So I don't.
Yeah.
I get stressed out sometimes, but it's a really beautiful thing for
yeah.
For me to have all these women, and.
Well, my father used to call it his harem, with. The white, my mother and my sister and myself, it makes a man, it's a different world for a man.
Yes. And I get out. I go climb mountains with
yeah.
Men, manly men, and ride my Harley, and I do like ultra manly
yeah.
Stuff now, like
yeah.
On a cliff with roped in and, you know, in a whiteout.
Yeah.
And I come back, you know, I call my wife on my way back down yeah. From the trip. Honey, I summited the, you know, whatever.
Yeah, I didn't
great,
jump.
Great. Yeah, yeah. You didn't jump. But, you know, I always get the, oh, that's great, honey. Can you pick up some milk on the way home?
Yeah.
Like, you know, I just conquered the world, hon.
Yeah.
You don't understand. Yeah, that's great. But and some shavers.
Yeah.
Can you get some of those, the girl shavers, some milk? So, yeah, brings me right back down.
Yeah. Did they ever travel with you on the?
Always. Yeah.
Yeah.
Not always. I mean, but
yeah.
a ton. And my girls have grown up. They've been around the world 4 times.
Oh, how wonderful. Yeah.
Great education for them.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, summers, if I summer tour, they're with me a lot. And yeah, we've been everywhere
yeah.
Together.
Now, tell me about Duff going back to college and starting another life.
So the start of my second life really
yeah.
Started coming out of that hospital in May of 1994 mm-hmm. And finding myself and the journey and finding that I'd made some money. The first order of business for me was just to stay
mm-hmm.
Sober. Second order of business was for me to get a handle on, I didn't want to be broke at 40. Who's got their hands in my
yeah.
Pot?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm sober. Figure it out. And I, of course, had these illusions of
yeah.
Grandeur. I'm going to look into these financial statements and shape up Guns N' Roses'
yeah.
Financial house. Well, I couldn't understand the financial statements.
Yeah.
So I was still down in L.A. I took a class right over here at Santa Monica College
mm-hmm.
That in the curriculum, part of it was understanding
yeah.
Financial statements. So there was my first step in. And I really liked this class, and the professor
yeah.
Was really great to me. We talked a lot after class about my financial statements.
Yeah.
I would black out the numbers, and we'd look at all the things. I got into another course
mm-hmm.
There, and then I thought, that's it. I'd met my wife now.
Yeah, Susan.
Susan, yeah.
Yeah.
During this point, and I said, okay, which was, of course,